So dear learners, very good day to all of you. Today we are talking about qualitative and quantitative analysis by chromatography. After completion of two modules, that is planar chromatography and theory of illusion chromatography, we will talk on evaluation part, that is qualitative and quantitative analysis. As you know, chromatography is mainly used as a tool to separate closely related chemical species, but it can also be used for qualitative as well as quantitative estimation of the separated species. Qualitative analysis by chromatography: identification of solutes which are separated by the chromatographic technique is the main purpose of qualitative analysis. Retention time of a solute or its position on the stationary phase after a certain elution period, for example, distance traveled by it in the column, can be used as a parameters for the identification of solutes by chromatography. A chromatographic technique is used for identifying only a limited number of species whose identities are known, but confirmation of identity always requires spectral or chemical investigation of the isolated compounds. At that time only, you can explore detailed structure of compound. Quantitative analysis by chromatography: the quantitative estimation by chromatography involves determination of the quantity of the separated fractions. In order to get the accuracy in quantification, the eluted compound should be detected accurately. The choice of detector in chromatography is thus extremely important. The sensitivity, linearity, and specificity of a detector play a major role in quantitative estimation by chromatography. For solutes getting separated in a smaller concentrations, amplification of the response obtained from the detector is important in getting higher accuracy. Another important parameter for getting higher accuracy in quantification by chromatography is the amount of sample used for loading the column. This is mainly limited by the range of linearity of the detector for different solutes. The specificity of the detector may cause certain peaks to be missed in the quantification process. Similarly, the flow rate of the mobile phase and the temperature of the column and detector determine accuracy of quantification. Example: differential refractive index detector requires good control on temperature, while ultraviolet detector is less critical in this respect. Quantitative analysis involves generally major three steps: the generation of the signal for each compound in the mixture by the detector after chromatographic separation, so as to produce different peaks in chromatogram; the measurement of some parameters for the peaks obtained in a chromatogram; and the calculation of concentration of the separated compounds from the measured parameters. Measurement of peak parameters in chromatography: various methods used to measure different parameters for the separated compounds in the chromatogram. Broadly, analysis based on peak height and analysis based on peak areas. Whereas in measurement of peak areas, there are five methods which can use for quantitative analysis. That is area measurement by triangulation technique, area measurement by width at half the height method, area measurement by planimetry, area measurement by cut and weigh method, and area measurement by using a ball and disc integrator. Now we will see one by one each method. You know, first analysis based on peak height. As you are observing in figure, the measurement of the height of peak is a common method of quantification. The height of a peak is measured by drawing a baseline on either side of a peak and then dropping a perpendicular on this baseline from the top center of the peak. The measurement of this perpendicular distance for the reference standard, that is H1, as well as for the separated compounds H2, helps in finding the actual concentration of the separated compound. Certain advantages: the measurement of the peak height gives accurate results, provided the widths during the period required to obtain chromatogram for a sample and a standard, the column temperature, the flow rate of the mobile phase, and the rate of sample injection are controlled properly. The peak heights are measured more easily and more accurately if the peaks are narrow. But here, disadvantage: if the column temperature, the flow rate of the mobile phase, and the rate of sample injection are not controlled properly, the variation in the peak widths is observed. As you are observing in figure 2, the change in the peak width results in the change in the peak height, leading to an inaccuracy in the measurement. Then another method, analysis based on peak areas. In order to avoid the variation in the measurement of peak height with the change in the peak width, another parameter, the peak area, is used for quantification. The peak area or under the curve is independent of the peak width. Thus, broadening of the peaks due to improper control on parameters involved in Van Dimter equation doesn't affect the accuracy of the quantification process. Hence, the measurement of the peak areas is preferred over the measurement of peak heights. A comparison of areas under the peak for a standard and a sample is made to find the concentration of each compound in the mixture. Advantage: the measurement of peak area is independent of the band broadening and hence offers the advantage of reproducibility. This is because if a band is sharp, its height is increased, and if the same band is broadened, its height is reduced. And you can observe in figure very well. The peak area measurement is the preferred parameter for the asymmetric or skewed peaks as well. But certain disadvantage: the measurement of peak areas is not as easy as the measurement of peak heights. The area determination is carried out either by performing calculation from height and width of the peak or by using some special device. So we will see in what way we can quantify things based on analysis based on peak areas. The chromatographic instruments are equipped with ball and disc or electronic integrators, which permit the precise estimation of peak areas. If such equipment is not available, a manual estimate must be made. And the peak areas are measured using different methods. And that is the first method, that is area measurement by triangulation technique. Most of the times, the chromatographic peaks are triangular in shape, and hence area under the triangular peak is obtained by applying the formula for the area of triangle, and that is A is equal to half into W into H, where W is the width of a peak and H is the height of a peak. In the presence of band broadening, the peak width cannot be measured accurately. Hence, whatever we are observing in a figure, the tangents are drawn along the sides of a triangle. The width of peak is taken as a distance between the two points of intersection, that is A and B of tangents with a baseline. And the height is measured from the baseline to the intersection of the two tangents at a point C. So obviously, certain advantages. It makes use of a simple formula for the calculation of area under the curve. But disadvantages: the triangulation technique is useful only for symmetrical peaks. Just fix in your mind. It involves a tedious job of putting tangents along the sides of a triangle. Drawing tangents on the sides of a triangle involves operator skill. There can be different values of height and width, and therefore of area of a triangle, depending on the actual position of tangents. So a slight error in drawing tangents can have a profound effect on the height measurement. Another method, area measurement by width at half the height method. To reduce the errors involved in measuring the width and the height of a peak in the triangulation technique, another more accurate method is used, wherein instead of measuring the width at the baseline, the width at half the height of a peak is measured. As you are observing in figure, height to width at half the height ratio of approximately 1/10 is considered to be the best. An area under the curve is calculated as the product of height and width at half the height. A, that is area, is equal to H into width 0.5, that is measurement of width at half the height. Now this method is having advantage. It reduces the errors due to tailing in the measurement of area, hence it is more accurate as compared to a triangulation technique. This technique doesn't require drawing tangents along the sides of a triangle, and hence it is a rapid and a simpler method compared to triangulation technique. Disadvantage: like a triangulation technique, this technique is also useful only for symmetrical peaks. Another method, area measurement by planimetry. Planimetry makes use of a device called a planimeter to measure the peak areas. As shown in diagram, a planimeter consists of a pivot in order to keep it fixed at one point. A pivot is connected through a movable shaft to a dial, which provides a digital display of the peak area during the measurement. This dial is in turn connected to another arm, which can move along the perimeter of a peak, and hence it is called as a perimetric technique. In advantage, we can say the technique of planimetry doesn't provide precise measurement of peak areas. Nevertheless, it is a more accurate than the triangulation technique. It finds wide application in determining the areas, particularly when the peaks are skewed and not symmetrical, because the true peak areas are measured. In disadvantage, the precision and accuracy of this method are dependent on the skill of an operator. The precision in the measurement can be improved by tracing each peak either from its inner or an outer side continuously. Also, the same peak is traced several times and the average of all the values is calculated. Because planimetry requires considerable operator skill and several measurements for the same peak, it is a tedious method and obviously it is a time consuming technique. Then area measurement by cut and weigh method. Like planimetry, this is also a perimetry technique. In this technique, the chromatographic peaks for the reference compound and the separated compounds from a sample are recorded on a high quality chart paper. This paper is cut along the perimeter of the peaks corresponding to a reference compound and the separated compounds. These cutouts are then weighed using an analytical balance. The comparison of the weights for the standard and the sample is made to find the concentration of each compound in the mixture. Having advantage, this method is found to be superior to the triangulation technique. It is more useful for the asymmetric or skewed peaks. Whereas in disadvantage, accuracy of the method depends on the accuracy of cutting the chart paper. The inaccuracy in the cutting procedure can be minimized by keeping the ratio of the height to width at half the height of a peak in the range of 1 to 10. A very high quality chart paper is essential in order to get reproducibility in the measurement. This requires the use of homogeneous and uniformly porous paper so as to get the constant weight per unit volume of the paper. The control on the moisture content of the paper is also required. This method is again time consuming. Area measurement by using ball and disc integrator. It is the most widely used device for measuring the area under the curve in chromatography. This device is present as a built-in device in the chromatograph. And main advantage of this method, this integrator provides the higher degree of automation and relatively higher accuracy as compared to whatever the techniques we have discussed so far. This technique can be used for the skewed peaks also. Other more modern methods used for quantification are the digital or electronic integrators and computers. So moving forward, conversion of numerical data to composition. The numerical data obtained in terms of height, area, or weight corresponding to the peak for the reference compound and that for the separated compounds is required to be converted to the concentration of a different compounds in the mixture. Important and commonly used methods to relate the digital data obtained from a chromatogram to the composition of the sample are normalization technique, internal standardization technique, external standardization technique, and preparation of calibration curve. Then we will try to explore each technique over here. Normalization technique. Consider chromatogram shown in figure. It shows elution of three compounds, and that is X, Y, and Z from their mixture. Let AX, AY, and AZ be the area under the curves for three compounds X, Y, and Z respectively. By using this method, percentage of each component in their mixture is calculated by using the formula. Such as percentage of X is equal to area of x divided by area of x plus area of y plus area of z. Means it is clear that in order to calculate the percentage of any one compound, it is essential to know the area under the curves for all the three compounds present in a mixture. Thus, complete elution of a sample is required even if one is interested in finding the amount of the compound getting eluted out first. The unnecessarily add ups to the time and cost of analysis. The normalization technique is used commonly when the separation are carried out by gas chromatography, because gas chromatography is much faster than liquid chromatography. And all the compounds are eluted out faster as compared to that in a liquid chromatography. In advantage, we can say this is a simple technique to calculate the percentage of compounds when limited number of compounds is present in a mixture. It doesn't require reference standard for finding concentration of compound. Whereas in disadvantage, elution of all the compounds in the sample is required even when the percentage of only one compound is to be determined. And this method is not used when the number of compounds is more, since the elution of a large number of compounds requires more time. Internal standard method. In this method, the amount of each compound in the mixture is calculated by using a reference standard. A reference standard is altogether a different compound than the compounds to be separated. Hence, the elution time of this reference compound is different from the elution time of any of the compounds getting separated from their mixture. The reference compound is mixed along with the mixture to be separated, and this mixture is injected in the column. Hence, the reference compound is called as an internal standard. The choice of an internal standard is made based on certain criteria. It must have completely different retention time than that for the compounds to be separated. It must not elute out far away from the compounds of interest. That is, it must elute out near the peaks of interest. It must be similar in a concentration to the compounds of interest. It must be chemically inert, and it must be absent in the sample. The internal standard and the compounds in the mixture separate depending on their retention time values from the height or the area of the peaks for the reference standard and the eluted compounds. The concentration of each compound in the mixture can be found. Let us have an example. Consider that the concentration of an internal standard is 10 microgram per ml, and it produces a peak corresponding to a height of 10 millimeter. As shown in diagram, one of the compounds, that is X, separated from the sample produces a peak corresponding to the height of 20 mm. Hence, the concentration of X in the sample is 20 microgram per ml. Thus, the height of peak for an internal standard and its concentration help in finding the concentration of the compounds present in the sample. Means we can say general formula: H standard into C standard is equal to H sample into C sample can be used to find the concentration of the sample. When height of standard and height of sample are the heights of the peaks for the standard and the sample respectively, and concentration of standard and concentration of sample are the concentrations of the standard and the sample respectively. Quantification using an internal standard provides a distinct advantages, and hence its use is preferred over an external standard method. So as of now, you are not knowing external standard method. So first of all, we will see advantage of this internal standard method and we will compare with external standard method. So in advantages of using an internal standard, instead of preparing separate solutions of an internal standard and the sample, if a single solution is prepared by mixing an internal standard along with the sample to be separated, higher accuracy is achieved in determining the concentration of the separated compounds. Since the error involved during dilution while preparing a common solution remains same for both, thus an internal standard which is added before the chromatographic process compensates for the errors during the preparation of the sample. Other errors associated with the apparatus, example change in temperature of the column, and with the procedure, example error during injecting the sample into the column, can also be eliminated by the use of an internal standard. Thus, the higher accuracy in the measurement is provided by using an internal standard method. Whereas in disadvantage, sometimes it's difficult to get a suitable internal standard. An internal standard may not elute out near the compounds of interest. An internal standard may not be soluble in the solvent in the concentration range corresponding to the compounds to be separated. And it may not be chemically inert. And in case of non-viability of an internal standard, an external standard can be used for quantification. Now let us have a look in external standard method. In comparatively, or maybe as name suggests, an external standard is used externally. That is, it is not mixed along with the sample to be separated. Thus, whenever an external standard is used, it is essential to prepare two separate solutions. One of an external standard and another of a sample to be separated. This is because for a mixture containing compounds X and Y, either X or Y can be used as an external standard. Thus, an external standard is one of the compounds of the sample itself and not an altogether different chemical. This external standard should be 100% pure, or it should be of a known purity. Since the retention time of an external standard, either X or Y, and one of the compounds of mixture match with each other, the standard and the sample cannot be mixed together. Hence, the solutions of an external standard and the sample are injected separately in the column. This produces two separate chromatograms, one for the standard and another for the sample. The height of the peaks for the compounds X and Y is then compared with the height of the peak for a standard, and their concentrations are determined. Now here on a slide you are observing internal standard method. Whereas in external standard method we have seen two times injections are required on a chromatographic column for a better separation. Obviously, advantages of using an external standard: there is no need to find a suitable chemical as a standard, since one of the compounds of the sample is used as an external standard. In disadvantage of using an external standard: errors occurring during weighing the standard and the sample and also during diluting their solutions make this process less accurate as compared to that carried out by using an internal standard. This method requires precise control on the analytical techniques, particularly while injecting the solution in the column. If an operator makes an error while injecting two solutions, standard and sample, to the column, the final calculation can involve error. For example, if the pressure applied on the piston of a syringe while injecting the solution of an external standard is less, it may leave few drops of solution in the syringe, thereby injecting less than the required amount of the standard solution in the column. However, while injecting the sample solution, if correct pressure is applied on the piston, when the sample solution is injected accurately in the column, if an accurate injection of a standard solution whose concentration is 10 microgram per ml produces a peak of 10 mm height, then the same solution when injected inaccurately would produce a peak of less than 10 mm height, maybe say around 8 mm. So without realizing the error made during injection of a standard, an operator would correlate the height of 8 mm with 10 microgram per ml concentration of the standard, and this would give incorrect concentration values for the separated compounds. So whenever an external standard is used, two chromatograms are required to be recorded as against one in case of method involving an internal standard. So obviously this process is more time consuming as compared to the internal standard method. Then moving on, next method, that is preparation of calibration curves. The calculation of the concentration of the separated compounds using an external standard is done many times by direct comparison of the height or area of an external standard with that of the separated compounds. However, sometimes the concentration is determined by preparing the calibration curves for the standard. In order to construct the calibration curves, the standard solution of the compounds of interest. Let us see in diagram, S1 for compound X and S2 for compound Y are prepared. An equal volume of the solutions is injected into a chromatograph. A chromatogram for S1 and S2. As you are observing in figure A, a separate chromatogram for the compound X and Y from the sample is also recorded, that is here in a figure B. The area under the curves for S1 and S2 is measured, whatever the area under the curves, S1 as well as the S2. And the concentration is plotted against the area as we are observing over here in this diagram. The unknown concentration of X and Y from the sample can be obtained by measuring area under their peaks and then dropping a perpendicular on the concentration axis. For example, area for X, you will draw perpendicular over here, that is concentration of X. Area for Y, you will draw perpendicular over here, that is concentration of Y. So another technique is to prepare the calibration curve by injecting varying amounts of the same standard solutions, either S1 or S2, and then plotting their areas against concentration. However, this method is less accurate due to the injection errors, and this method is usually used to analyze single compound or simple mixtures. So dear learners, we will conclude this session with a quote of the day. Nothing can harm you as much as your own thoughts unguarded, by Lord Buddha. So have a nice time and have a safe thought.